Hi, my name is Roz Humphreys, and today we're going to continue defining those characteristics that do not define God in the love chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And it says that love does not traffic shame nor disrespect. That love does not traffic shame nor disrespect. So you have to be on a road to get into traffic, right? So the road of shame is the one that we choose to travel. And I know that sometimes that's very hard to hear because sometimes shame is put on us. If you think about it, when we were younger, we probably had parents or teachers that said, shame on you when we did something wrong. And so that's put on us at times. Or sometimes things happen to us by choice or because of something that happened to us and we think that we should be the blame and we walk in shame. But that's not part of what God's characteristic is. As a matter of fact, when we start to walk in shame, what happens is that we hide the real us, you know, the real person inside of us. And my book, Stop Ignoring Me, I wrote about how when women are traveling in shame, how they're walking in shame, that they wear a mask. And when you're wearing a mask, people are only seeing a little part of you. They're not seeing the real you. When you wear a mask, you're hiding who you are, who you truly are. And usually we're hiding because of fear, because of shame. We're walking in shame, and that's not part of God's characteristic, and He doesn't want that for us as well. So shame was introduced very early in Scripture. If you turn to Genesis chapter 3, let's read it together and let's go through it. So it says, "Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?'" And what I found interesting was that it says that he was cunning than any other, which means that there were other cunning beasts there at that time. And cunning means that they keep trying to strategize and find a way to get their point across so that you can agree, right? So a lot of times people think that that Eve and the serpent only have one conversation. No, they didn't have one conversation. This was happening over time. He kept questioning her. And that's how the enemy works today. He takes it, he starts putting little doubts in your mind. He starts questioning so that you can take and start thinking and saying, well, you know, maybe he's right. For example, the doubt that he's probably putting in some people's mind right now is, look, they tell you that God is good, but look, you're broke. You don't have any money. There's no income. Look, you don't have a job. How are you going to support your family? How could God be good? How could God be your supporter? How could God be taking care of you if all this is happening to you? You know what? This is the way that the enemy drops things into your mind, into your head, so that it creates doubt, so that you do not believe Scripture, so that you do not believe what God said. So he used Scripture. He used the Word of God. You know, it might have not been on paper at the time, but he used the Word of God. He took God's Word and he threw it right back at her. Oh, look at this. Do you really think this is going to happen? Look at this. This is why he said, I know, but do you really believe that's going to happen? How many times does the enemy do that? That God tells us something in his word and he starts putting seeds of doubt, right? It says, "And the woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the tree of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die.'" So she went back with Scripture at him, right? She went back with God's word at him. And then he says, "Then the serpent said to the woman, 'You will surely not die.'" So he challenged God's word. And he will always do that. That is his MO. "For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing of good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate it. And she also gave to her husband, and he ate. Now, that verse alone is like, you can unpack it and it'll tell you everything about, you know, what happens during temptation. But we're going to be talking about shame, so we'll stick with that, right? But the one thing I do want to add is that she gave it to her husband and he ate. You know, he did not maintain his rightful position at that time. And it's sad to say that in these days, some women do not allow their husbands to take their rightful position within their within their home, which is to be the priest of the house. You know, they're supposed to be the priest of the house. We're supposed to submit to them. I know that that's a verse that women, you know, they get like the prickly hairs on the back of their neck, right? But this is scripture. This is scripture. And so if Adam had taken his rightful position, he would have said, I'm not going to eat that, because the Lord said no, or he would have stopped her. But he didn't take his rightful position. He didn't take his rightful position. And in these days, I don't know about those days, but in these days, a lot of women won't let men, because they keep talking down to them, because they keep telling them that they're not doing what they're supposed to do, or because they keep measuring their spiritual life or their spiritual walk according to them. And they're criticizing them so much that the men get turned off and they say, I'm not doing anything right, so why should I even do this right? Because I'm going to keep getting hammered about this. And some of you need to hear this. Let your man be the spiritual leader in your household. Let him learn how to do it. You are not his Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit will teach him. Just give him to God and just worry about you. Worry about you. Speak to God about you. Only God can change you, because you have to bend your will to God's. Just like your husband, only God can deal with your husband. So just leave him to God. You know, the Holy Spirit is the best person that you can leave him to. All right, so let's go back. And so they said, then the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves covering. So this whole time they were naked, didn't bother them, didn't faze them. All of a sudden, they eat the fruit, their eyes are open. What happened was that they were able to know the difference between good and evil. They knew nothing about evil at that time, and God wanted to spare them. But now they opened their eyes, they realized they were naked. First thing, shame came in. And they said, I gotta cover myself, right? And then they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden, the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. So Adam was feeling shame, and so was Eve. And so they hid themselves. Fear became one of their motives. They didn't know fear at that time. They didn't know shame. Fear and shame go hand in hand. So they hid themselves. But you know what's the beautiful part that people often miss about this? God knows everything. He knew that they actually ate from the fruit, and yet he still looked for them. He went in the cool of the garden and he looked for them. He looked for them to have time with them, to have relationship with them. And then the Lord called Adam and said to him, "Where are you? Where are you? Come on, let's hang out together." And so he said, "I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself." So shame will make you want to hide. Even though God is looking for you, even though God wants relationship with you, despite of what you're feeling, right? It causes us to hide. And there are some of you that have to be freed from that shame that you're carrying. You're probably carrying it for years and years, and God wants to free you. You know, he sent Jesus here so that you can be free of shame. We're talking about the characteristics that do not define God, and shame is not part of it. Shame is not part of it. If anything, he's pleased with you. He is pleased with you. It says in scripture that We should be going boldly, right, to the throne of grace, and yet there's so many of us that are hanging their head low when we should be hanging our head high, because God says He is the lifter of our heads. He is the lifter of our heads. And all we have to do, right, is go to the cross. Go to the cross, you know, and put the shame at the foot of the cross, because Jesus already carried it. So I want to do a prayer for you today as we close, because I don't want you to walk in shame. And we're going to be unpacking, you know, shame and the opposite of shame, of how God truly wants us to walk and travel. He wants to travel on the road of freedom. That is why He sent Jesus. So just, you know, I want to pray for you today. I want to help you feel free inside. Father God, I ask You in the name of Jesus that You just touch my brother or my sister, Lord, that maybe is still traveling in shame, Lord God. I ask You in the name of Jesus that they loose, Lord God. They loose, because You said whatever we loose on earth will be loose in heaven. That they loose, Lord God, shame, because it's not in heaven, Lord God. That's not how we travel, Lord. And that You bind, Lord, forgiveness and love, Lord God, that they may forgive others and forgive themselves, that they may bind Your love in their soul, Lord God, and start walking in freedom. Father God, I thank You, Lord God. I thank You, God, because I know that even now You're working on their heart because You love them. I hope that you enjoyed this today. On our next session, we're going to continue about the characteristics that do not define God, because God is not ashamed of you. He loves you. He loves you.